Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Centrality of the Church, Practicing the Ways of God with the People of God by Tony Evans. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Introduction. As a pastor or church leader, you already know the critical importance of the church and the need for its impact on culture. You understand the role the church is to play in transferring the values of the kingdom of God into the everyday reality we all face on earth. I don't need to convince you that the church should be leaving an imprint of Christ's nature and attributes on believers as well as on society at large. But what I may need to do, and what I hope to accomplish in our time in these chapters, is to explain to you just how the church can function in order to fully flesh out her purpose. Weak churches leave little impact. Your role is to create the environment where your church not only grows and develops strong members through the process of discipleship, but also equips your members to make individual as well as collective impact. When the church is strong, its members recognize their eternal purpose, and the church moves forward. But when the church is weak, its members tend to wander around in confusion on their spiritual pilgrimage. My purpose and prayer for this book is that it will contribute to our understanding of the centrality of the church and the key leadership role of the pastor and church leaders. When our members become dynamic followers of Jesus Christ and contributing members of His church, we can and will transfer God's kingdom agenda values to the world as a whole. Chapter 1. The Kingdom. In most recognized countries in the world, there is an American embassy, which is like a little bit of America a long way from home. Embassies have special immunities and protections from local law enforcement. The host nation's law enforcement can only enter the embassy with the ambassador's permission. If you get into trouble in a hostile country, make your way to the American embassy, because once you cross the gate and enter the realm of its dominion, you are under the protection of the embassy. The church is supposed to be a little bit of heaven a long way from home. It is to be that place where the values of eternity operate in history. The church is a place where weary people can go to find the truth, acceptance, equality, freedom, safety, joy, justice, and hope. It is to serve as a centralized role in culture. Pastor, your job is not only to preach God's word, but also to administrate the critical operations of the church in such a way that your church fulfills its purpose in society. Unfortunately today, far too many pastors lead their churches with a myopic view on the church's purpose. After all, how is it possible for the number of churches in our nation to be ever increasing while the impact of the church only wanes? How can we have so much preaching, praising, programs, and ministry resources, and yet so little demonstrated power? Why does the church merely react to society's agenda rather than offering a kingdom agenda for its members as well as for society to embrace? The answers to these questions lie in the reality that the church today bears little resemblance to the kingdom from which we came. This is because we have failed to function from a kingdom perspective. The church has stopped being the biblical church that it was designed to be, and as a result, we have limited our impact on contemporary society, both inside and outside our walls. Throughout Scripture, God's agenda is His kingdom. The Greek word used for kingdom is basileia, which essentially means rule or authority. A kingdom always includes three crucial components. First, a ruler empowered with sufficient authority. Second, a realm of subjects who fall underneath this authority, and third, the rules of governance. God's kingdom is the authoritative execution of His comprehensive governance in all creation. Therefore, the universe we live in is a theocracy. Theos refers to God. Ocracy refers to rule. A kingdom perspective means that the rule of God, theocracy, trumps the rule of man, homocracy. Psalm 103 verse 19 expresses it this way: "The Lord has established His throne in heaven, and His kingdom rules over all." New International Version. Therefore, the kingdom agenda is the visible manifestation of the comprehensive rule of God over every area of life. To understand your role as a pastor of a church and the church's centrality in our culture, you have to first understand the kingdom from a biblical perspective. God's kingdom is larger than the temporal, political, and social realms in which we live. It's not confined to the walls of the church in which we worship Him. The kingdom is both now, Mark chapter 1, verse 15, and not yet, Matthew chapter 16, verse 28. It is among us, Luke chapter 17, verse 21, but also in heaven, Matthew chapter 27, verse 21, and 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 18, since it originates from above, from another realm. Jesus revealed that truth shortly before His crucifixion, when He said in response to Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world. If My kingdom were of this world, then My servants would be fighting so that I would not be handed over to the Jews. But as it is, My kingdom is not of this realm." John chapter 18, verse 36. While God's kingdom is in this world, it does not originate from this world. Since it originates from another realm, God established covenants within the world we live through which to implement it. A covenant is a divinely created relational bond through which God executes and administers His kingdom agenda. These covenants are governmental systems or institutions designated as family, church, and civil government, state. God rules them all, and each one is to be accountable to Him and His standards as their sovereign. Whether or not mankind functions in alignment with His rule is another story. Regardless, God has given the guidelines by which all three are to operate because He is the originator of all three. Failure to operate under His authority within those guidelines results in negative consequences. The three, while distinct in their responsibilities and jurisdiction, are to cooperate with each other with the common goal of producing personal responsibility and individuals who govern themselves under God. None of these governing spheres is to be viewed or is to operate as an all-powerful and controlling authority over the others. Operating under God. The foundation on which all three institutional covenants operate is that of an absolute standard of truth. This standard of truth is non-negotiable, non-adjustable, and transcends cultural, racial, and situational lines. Truth is fundamentally God-based knowledge, since God is both the originator and the author of truth. Not only does the kingdom agenda operate on this foundation of truth, but it also operates under the only all-inclusive principle presented to us for understanding the work of God and His kingdom. This principle is His glory. Romans chapter 11, verse 36 says, "For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be the glory forever. Amen." Glory simply means to be heavy or to have weight. It denotes significance. Since all things come from God, are through God, and go to God, God's glory exists intrinsically in Himself. Whether we ascribe glory to God or not is irrelevant to the amount of glory God has. His glory is already fully present in Him. However, we experience and access that glory when we place ourselves under His comprehensive rule. This is because it is then that God radiates and magnifies His glory to, in, and through us. A primary position for bringing glory to God is that of surrender to His sovereignty. To surrender to God's sovereignty is to acknowledge His jurisdiction, along with the validity of His supremacy, over every area of life. God is accountable to no one. He either causes all things to happen or He permits them to happen. Sovereignty means that God never says, "Oops, I missed that one." When we lead our churches by the principles of the kingdom agenda, we experience God's hand in every area of our church as well as within our church members' lives and thereby witness His promise to work all things together for good. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. As people are conformed to the image of Christ in their attitudes and actions, character and conduct begin to reflect Christ all the more. However, what we often do is limit our opportunity to experience God working all things together for good by defining God according to our purpose rather than His. Humanism and socialism, whether it be in the form of modern-day churchism, materialism, me-ism, statism, liberation theology, or Marxism, offers an insufficient understanding of the purpose, work, and revelation of God. It attempts to box God into a kingdom confined within the perspective of man. Yet, when the human condition is used as the starting point for seeing the whole of God's revelation rather than a surrender to His sovereignty over the whole of the human condition, faulty theology and sociology emerge. What we wind up with is a God fashioned in the image of man. A kingdom perspective does not view man's condition first and then assign to God what we feel would best reflect Him. Rather, a kingdom perspective ascertains how God has determined to glorify Himself comprehensively in the affairs of men, and then aligns itself with that despite our inability to always understand God's processes. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. However, God's definition of good isn't always ours. In fact, God often uses the very thing that we call not good as a tool to bring about an ultimate purpose, as well as the resultant manifestation of His greater glory. For example, according to the covenant with Abraham in Genesis chapter 15, slavery in Egypt was an intricate part of God's program for the nation. We read, God said to Abraham, "Know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, where they will be enslaved and oppressed 400 years, but I will also judge the nation whom they will serve, and afterward they will come out with many possessions." Genesis chapter 15, verses 13 through 14. The point here is that God, in accomplishing His kingdom agenda, allowed a negative reality that could have been avoided if He had chosen for it to be. Yet, the reality of the Israelites' slavery in Egypt accomplished a higher purpose of establishing God's theocratic relationship with them based on an exodus that would serve as a constant reminder of who had brought them out. Exodus chapter 12, verse 42. This truth served as a foundational relational principle in the future movements of God with the Israelite community. God's sovereignty in the midst of what we do not understand is echoed elsewhere throughout the Bible. Another example is found in the life of Joseph, who had been sold into slavery by his brothers. Joseph later said to his brothers, "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result, to preserve many people alive." Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. The freedom that is actualized through a kingdom perspective, that of embracing God's sovereignty, generates a faith and ministry perspective more powerful than any human weapon or system of philosophy could ever produce. It accesses God's grace in such a way so as to grant a freedom that is not incumbent upon externals. This is the only true authentic freedom as it manifests God's ability to bring about good in any and every situation surrendered to Him. While God is a God of liberation and justice, and while we should be about the same, a kingdom perspective recognizes that in His sovereignty, His timing is not always the same as our own. However, a kingdom theology also recognizes that while there remain oppression and injustice in the world's systems, they should never be tolerated within the Church of God or among members within the body of Christ. In fact, whenever Jesus proclaimed the kingdom of God during His earthly presence, He did so while simultaneously healing, helping, feeding, and freeing the hurting and the lost. Therefore, any pastor of any church who minimizes legitimate social needs has failed to model the church he leads after the one whom we have been given to follow, thereby reducing the glory his church gives to God as well as its impact on the world. Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. While we may not always understand God's processes or His timing, a kingdom theology recognizes that God's purpose does not change, and that purpose is to glorify Himself. the ultimate goal of the kingdom is always Godward. Therefore, living the kingdom agenda means that the comprehensive rule of God is the final, authoritative, and governing principle in our personal lives, family lives, churches, and communities in order that God may manifest His glory while advancing His kingdom. The socio-political distinction of the kingdom. The problem we face in the church today is that churches have misunderstood and undervalued the kingdom, thereby marginalizing its authority and influence not only in the lives of its members, but also in our land. Many in the church have so spiritualized the kingdom that its socio-political rules have become little more than an ethereal ideology to be displayed at a later date. This has led to a reduction of the vast socio-ethical implications in the church, creating an organism whose function offers little power toward the transformation of its members and their impact in the world. However, the socio-political nature of the kingdom of God is very real, biblically substantiated, and relevant to the embracing of the church's purpose. We first witness the socio-political distinction of the kingdom in Satan's challenge to God's rule. This challenge, while spiritual, was also political in nature in that it involved an attempt to secure a throne only God had the right to possess. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 11 through 19, and Isaiah chapter 14, verses 13 through 17. It was Satan who said, "I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God, and I will sit on the mount of assembly." Isaiah chapter 14, verse 13. Satan's desire to sit on the Mount of Assembly was his attempt to hold the seat of divine government in the spiritual realm while getting Adam to surrender it in the physical realm. From the beginning, politics was an issue in the rule of God. Other demonstrations of the socio-political nature of God's kingdom include the command God gave to Adam that he was to subdue the earth under him, revealing the combination of the spiritual and physical aspects of a theocratic kingdom. See Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. Next, the specific institution and creation of national government directly relate God's kingdom program to the social and political aspects of man as well, especially since capital punishment is instituted in this period. See Genesis chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. That capital punishment was predicated on the fact that man is made in the image of God, verse 6, underscores the truth that God's kingdom rule in the area of human justice has a spiritual and theological basis. Further, under the patriarchs, Abraham was a participant in a covenant that included both land and seed. God promised to bless others through Abraham by making him into a great nation. This would come through the multiplication of his seed. Yet, Genesis chapter 15, verses 18 through 21, also describes the portion of the covenant specifically dealing with the land promised to Abraham. This covenant became the basis for Israel's spiritual as well as socio-political existence. See Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Likewise, whether in the conflict of Moses with the Pharaoh or in the judges, the theocratic role in governing the nation involved social, political, and economic forces as the means of expressing God's rule on earth. Looking toward the millennial kingdom, Messiah's righteous rule, we also see a reflection of the social structure of the kingdom, demonstrating the inseparability of the socio-political aspects from the spiritual. Christ's future rule will bring about changes within the structures of society. It will mean that military warfare will cease. Psalm 46, verses 8 through 9, Micah chapter 4, verse 3, and Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 through 7. Slums will be removed. Psalm 72, verse 16. Political wrongs will be righted. Isaiah chapter 2, verse 4, and Psalm 72, verse 4, and physical disease will disappear. Isaiah chapter 35, verses 5 through 6, and Isaiah chapter 33, verse 24. The church as an alternative model for the world. The church is the nursery of the kingdom, housing its values and exposing them to the broader society. The biblical purpose of the church, then, in light of the nature of the kingdom, is to reflect the spiritual, socio-political, and socio-ethical aspects of the kingdom. It is to be a model for the world operating in the world while providing an alternative to the world. When the church functions as a kingdom community, not as a reaction to the world's ungodly system, but rather as a divine structure operating in a liberating manner according to the way God has ordained it to be, the church sets itself apart as a haven, much like an embassy. This then shows those who are in the kingdom of darkness a preview of what the kingdom of God is all about. In the movies, previews advertise coming attractions. Designed to entice, the preview focuses on the hot clips of the movies, such as the chase scenes, love scenes, and fight scenes. The point of the preview is to whet our appetites for the upcoming attraction. Someday a big show is coming to town, and it's called the Kingdom of God. God the Father is the producer. The Holy Spirit is the director. Jesus is the superstar, and it will be a worldwide production. But until then, God has left previews of coming attractions in the world. We are His hot clips. God has left His church here to provide clips of the major production that is to come. Thus, the church does not merely exist for the church, but for God's bigger goal, which is the expansion of His kingdom. Unfortunately, most of our clips have been so weak in demonstrating the power and wonder of the feature film that few people show interest in picking up a free ticket. Instead of previewing an epic, we often merely reflect the sitcoms and soap operas around us. Until we, as God's people, intentionally embrace, apply, and reflect the kingdom, the church has little to offer the world. While there is war in the world, there ought to be the existence of peace in the church. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. Colossians chapter 3, verses 14 through 15. And prayer for peace by the church. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. While there is oppression in society, there ought to be liberation and justice in the church. James chapter 2, verses 1 through 9. While there is poverty in the world, there ought to be voluntary.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.